Well, the my talk today is about the supercomputing of the whole body neuromuscular skeletal system. But since I learned the diversity of the interest of this group, I just want to explain some of our related works first, and then go to the computing problem. For a long time, my interest is the anthropomorphism, why the human shape or animal shape is so important. I think that is the key essence for me about the biomimetic from point of view. Well, this is of course very famous drawing. Of course, the story is created in this country, and this picture is so complex to me, but this is easy for children to understand what's going on. I think this is because it's not because of love, it's because of anthropomorphism. And also long time ago, to define the concept of the nation, the famous person used this kind of picture to explain it. I think the human shape or human existence is very important to explain not only the human behaviors but also for other animals or very abstract concept. So I think this is very curious for me. Why is it so? Well, being in the mechanical informatics, this is the department in between mechanical engineering and computer science. So we have been interested in building the humanoid robot like this. So we spend, actually, this was intended to participate in the robotic challenge like the Professor Anthony Dickey's group, but we couldn't make it in time. But still, we have been working on this. This is the hydraulic robotic systems. Without using any valves, we use the hydrostatic transmission for all the actuators. So we develop all the actuators in-house, and even the hand system is designed using our own actuator. We have five small hydraulic actuators in the forearm and control the actuated forefinger and hand. Well, this is one of our interests. And the other one is related to more informatics. We have been analyzing the human motions from informatics point of view. This is just an example of some data we were using. We are also taking a lot of human motion data in-house, but this is the case of the CMU data. And we segmented and classified all the data by using the statistical method. And this is the quite interesting project for us. In Japan, there is the radio exercise that is quite well known for children or other people, that people are encouraged to do the exercise hearing the music from the radio. This is a very healthy the custom. And we have segmented and classified and even made the temporal sequence of the motions. This is like the subway lines. So one kind of sequence of motions can be modeled as a line, and we can make many lines. And by knowing this kind of map, we can even estimate the next motion or future motion of the person. This can be statistically done. So this is the experiment. So this is exactly the radio exercise, and this white person is the current motion. It is taken from the motion capture system and visualized in real time. And the motion is in real time segmented and stored in this. And meanwhile, by using the previous knowledge, we try to estimate his future motion. And this red person is his one segment ahead of time. And this yellow is two segments ahead of time. One segment is typically 1.5 or 2 seconds. So we can estimate his future motion, if you like. So when the person needs some help, we have, you know, 2 seconds or 4 seconds time to come close to him and help. Well, this kind of work has been led by our colleague Professor Wataru Takano. He completed his PhD in our lab and became associate professor. And of course, naturally, after making the segmented symbolic data set, we want to connect this data set with linguistic system. And all kinds of the linguistic deassociation and the motion association is done based on the statistical mathematics. It is very straightforward and very nice for us. And this is the Professor Takano's lecture in the classroom. And he was wearing the wireless the motion capture system and taking these very motions even in the classroom. And by having some example data with the text information, we can use them to train the relationship between motion and the word. And the sentences are just created in a very natural way based on the statistical reason. So these are the three or maybe four most likely sentences that can explain his motions. Maybe this is his office. He's working with computer or doing something. So this is very simple. So we don't use any object or personal cognition. This is just based on the motion data. So of course, this must be combined with facial recognition or object recognition or other sensory systems to make more useful. Okay, now we can start with the computational program. The many of our ex-students and staff and they have contributed a lot. And these are just a few of those contributors. And well, the other very standard discipline we have been interested in the efficient computation of dynamics and kinematics. At around the year 2000, we published a paper called Structure Bearing Kinematic Chain that can handle open kinematic chain or closed kinematic chain or free-flowing kinematic chain very consistently. And by just setting the index of contact, then we can use only one algorithm to compute all kind of motions. So this paper fortunately received the best transaction paper by AAA of year 2001. And then the Professor Yamane, he was a PhD student, worked on the parallel computation and more efficient computation. So order in computation with single processors is developed, and then the parallel computation of the order log n were developed based on the same idea. So this is our background. And then we decided to apply this to more complicated systems than just block or human block. So so we have been using the motion capture system. This is very typical screen of the motion capture system. And we have this, the brown part of the floor is a pulse sensor. Pulse sensor is a very expensive device that can measure the six-axis forces, only six-axis pulse information. And we also attach some wireless EMG detectors on the surface of the body. typically we use 16, but sometimes we use 32. And then, I hope it moves. So, maybe link it though. Okay, anyway, based on the motion capture data, we can create the motion of the skeletons. This is standard exercise, but we developed all the inverse kinematics algorithms in-house. And then we can visualize the muscle and muscle activities. And this is the muscle model that the two of our students spent maybe almost 1 year to make all the data. So we have nearly 1,000 muscles. This is too many probably, but this is because we represent one large muscles by several wires. So we have nearly 1,000 wires, and we have tendon, ligament, cartilage, and many others. So this is highly complex system. And doing this kind of modeling and computation, we make the large scale optimization. Optimization does taking account of the motion capture data, that is the joint motion and the floor force motion, contact floor force motion, floor force data, and also 16 EMG data. And taking account all of them, we can make best estimate of muscle activities of all the wires, 1,000 wires. This is about the nearly 2,000 variable problem, and we can solve this in real time. That means in the fluid. This picture is generated after computation because quality picture takes more time to visualize. But in real time, we can visualize this kind of motion. This is the instructor of maybe teaching the walking style. So she is making very elegant walking, as you can see. Well, we had the chance to visualize the muscle activities of athlete. C is the silver medalist of the London Olympic, and she came to our lab a couple months before the Olympic, and she is very skillful. And typically, maybe he's also the Olympic athlete at the London Olympic, and those athletes that typically use the muscles non-antagonistic way in order to maximize the velocity and also in order to minimize the fatigue or others. So they are very typical. And in the case of this weightlifting lady, she is very skillful and she can bring the weight immediately just about the angle. This is very important. So very precisely, she must bring the weight just above some, using only one side of the muscle. This is important. Well, we also had a chance to measure the football player. This is the Andres Iniesta in the FC Barcelona. And we had just 1 hour to measure him. Very expensive experiment. I mean, we didn't pay. The broadcasting station offered our opportunity. But he canceled many times. So last week we had only 1 hour. Well, in the TV program, this picture was not used, unfortunately. They used just a skeletal motion. They were not interested in the muscular activities. Well, I'm showing because it is my favorite things. He's a famous tap dancer. He was on the Kitano Takeshi's movie, and he's he can make top 16 times per second. So the it was hard for us to detect the precise contact timing. So we used the additional high speed camera to just look at the contact timing. Also, he's also a very famous professional drummer, but his drumming style is very unique. He doesn't look like a percussionist. So you see the white ball. White ball is the center of mass. He controlled his posture and center of mass very stable, precisely. And because of that, he can look at the audience really, and he doesn't look at the drum set at all. So he stabilized very well, and he can play without looking at any position of the drum set. And he even said that he doesn't use muscles. I know it's not true, but the difficulty is the detecting the timing of contact. In this case, the timing was around the 1 millisecond. So it's not being done by a conventional motion capture system. We attach the accelerometer or the microphone or many other additional sensors to detect contact times. Well, sorry for Japanese, but we had a chance to measure the performance of So this is the young no player. No play is the one of the UNESCO national treasure in Japan and a very old play, even older than the kabuki or other traditional play. And the uniqueness is that they minimize the emotions. They don't want to show the emotions. So they try to hide the change of CON. It's very strange. And they just control the head orientation within 5 degrees. This is what they say. If they lower 5 degrees, that shows that he is expressing the very sad emotion. If he lays 5 degrees, that means he's happy or. And if he's so straight, it is different. So the motion and expression is minimized. And the question is how he can do this kind of the motions. We even captured the motion of the musician along with him, and we wanted to analyze the coordination of the music and the motion, but this is still undergoing project. Yeah, this is one of our discovery. After a very quiet time, he has to hit the floor to make big sound. After a long silence, he has to do this immediately. And of course, he doesn't want to show the change of CON. So the question is how he can raise one leg and hit to make big sound without moving CON. He does. And by looking at this is nothing very, scientific, musculoskeletal analysis doesn't make any contribution, but just measuring the contact force, it turned out that when he raised the leg one leg, he's jumping with the other leg. In that way, he doesn't need to change the shoe. And then he hit the floor. Again, he jumped with the other side of the leg. So he's jumping twice to make a sound. So this is how the note player does the very minimum motions. Well, this is very new. This is totally new. Nobody else seen in the world. And last week, the NHK broadcasting station showed the our analysis of the judo player. He's going to be in the Rio Olympic and expected the gold medal at the 100 kilogram class. He's a very famous judo player. And his style is this. This is only his style, but the opponent side cannot avoid this. The question is why he can do this. Of course, it's not too easy to explain. But this is a result of musculoskeletal analysis, and it is surprising that, sorry for the very small graph, this is not intended for presentation, this is only for internal data, but this is from, so maybe. From here to here is 0.1 seconds, and this is the timing that he slow the person. So probably within just 10 milliseconds, he contract the muscle at the maximum excitement. So from here, this is the time to switch the supporting legs from right to left, or left to right, I don't remember, but switching time. So from one side to other side he's switching, and then immediately, within 10 milliseconds, he throws that person. And from here to here, within here to here, he is jumping with the supporting leg. When he throws the opponent player, I cannot play, but he is jumping this way. So the contact force is becoming zero at this point. And the opponent person will, fly and fall down within 1 second. So anyway, the amazing is that this timing is only, 100 milliseconds. This is much less than 100 milliseconds, and this is less than probably 10 milliseconds. And human response for the 100 meter run is, after the starting pistol, is expected more than 100 milliseconds. Right? So within that short time, he's switching the supporting leg and maximizing the muscles. This is how they work. And this is the result of the visualization. By the way, it is very important to feel the other side of the person by hand. He's grabbing this part and also sleeves, and by grabbing those points, he can learn the reaction of the other players. So these four sensations are most important. The visual sensation is not helpful because it's slow, and also that his size is only limited to very small area. So force feedback or force sensation is the main part of the neuroplay. Okay, so supercomputing. We have been involved in the National Supercomputing Project. We are just a small player, but we enjoy working with people like Shin Takagi and Kenji Doya at the Okinawa Institute of Science and Technology. And the supercomputer is it used to be number one supercomputer in the world, but now it's much lower. But for the recent newspaper said that for the big data computation, still this king computer is the number one in the world. So we had the opportunity to use this computer for our model. So the whole project was very ambitious, and I think it's too ambitious for us, but the goal was to simulate the Parkinson's disease, the symptoms of the Parkinson's disease. And very fascinating plenary talk, and everyone knows more about the role of patient memory and how the Parkinson's disease caused by the dysfunction of the patient memory. But it is very typical and important in many sense. And Parkinson's disease starts from the stem of the brain and then spread into the whole area very gradually. So it is very serious disease, of course. And this is somewhat similar to what yesterday's plenary talk explained, but I can't explain very well. And the essence to me is that just because of the dysfunction of the brain cells in the patient ganglia, and the brain start to strange functions. The other part of the brain and the other part of the body is healthy, but only because of the dysfunction of the dopamine related cells, the phenomena or the symptoms are stimulated. And there are many symptoms according to the neuroclinic website, tremor and slow movement, limited muscles, and impaired posture and balance, and so on and so forth. But we were just looking at tremor, and maybe we can start something like limited muscles state. So our partner at Okinawa Institute of Science and Technology was focusing on developing the simulation of this circuit, including the basal ganglia and the cortex, motor cortex. And we were looking at the typical frequency of the neural activities, and it seems that after holding the Parkinson's disease, the typical frequency in motor cortex becomes 5 to 6 cells. I don't know why, but this is typically observed, and the Okinawa's group tried to simulate how it happens. Okay, so the project is quite complex. So we need the brain model, we need musculoskeletal model, we need FEM muscle model. And FEM computer software was originally exist in Fortran, so but we have to rewrite all of them to be connected to the C to all the other part. And the next is a very well known environment modeling the neural system. And the members of Okinawa's group and also we helped and develop the pioneers. That means that we can develop the neural model by Python and connect it to the nest. So this is the whole system. The music is the environment to connect the the dynamics or kinematics computation with the neural computations. So all of these components must be consistently connected. This was a quite a large effort we spent for the first phase. And the one of our postdoc, he's now in Heidelberg, did a nice work. He studied the modeling the motor neurons and sensory neurons. And in this case, the muscles are just nine muscles, like the, our previous pictures. But he spent a lot of time building the motor neurons and the sensory neurons, muscle spindle neurons of the bicep and tricep to control the elbow. So the investigating the literatures and the number of known number of motor neurons and muscle spindles neurons, he made the 3D model of the distribution of the neurons in the spine or outside spine, since the neurons are outside and they are connected to the muscles. And he tried to investigate how to train and make the define the parameters to model the reflex motion of the just elbow motion. And he did some experiment. I just want to explain it enough. But we also used the well-known in our musculoskeletal model, we use a famous Hugh model, and we take account of the length of muscles or velocity of muscles and others. And A is the muscle activities. And if we have the EMG, the A is approximated by EMG. And the spinal neurons model was adapted, and we have to interpret spinal signal to the analog signal of the activities. So those kind of interfaces found in the literature. So we can translate the spinal signal to the analog signal of the activities or vice versa. Well, of course, we have to have many parameters, but very simplified. We have just the defined the typical membrane potential, and we have just defined simple capacitance, and all the other part of the data is modeled by the size of motor neurons. So the size of motor neurons define the difference of parameters. So anyway, this is just a simple elbow motions, but according to the Manish algorithm, he can simulate how the reflex motion is created. Of course, we don't use any, in this case, we didn't use any interneurons. We just use the monosynaptic connection. Okay? So, now, starting with this model, we then started to make the finite element musculoskeletal modeling. This is quite a big challenge. I just want to make a long story short. So we have 1,000 muscles. They are the viscoelastic bodies. And we have nearly 160 bones, and they are connected. And bones are assumed that the lift body linkage, and each muscle is the viscoelastic body, homogeneous viscoelastic body. And their deformation is defined by the injected signal from the motor point or motor neurons. And the each muscle, of course, are being activated independently. And they are, you know, physically interacting with each other. And the deformation is defined by the interaction, and also the actual, the muscle force through the bone is also, coordinated by the interaction. So we have to compute all the interactions between 1,000 muscles. Of course, the one muscle is contacting with few neighboring muscles, but we have to consider all of them. So the our core and server is now in AISC. He developed the parallel computing of all of the system. So each muscle is computing in one process. But 1,000 muscles is computed in power. And we can compute all kind of contact and interacting force and deformations in power. But let me skip. This is how the contact is identified. This is very typical, how power. So starting from the big bounding box, we have to, make narrowize and find out the typical point of contact. This is very difficult part and time consuming. But this kind of computation is done in real time. And this is just a simple testing of the example. Okay, let's skip. This is nothing scientific, but we can test by using this. And of course, the we can verify the computational performance by parallel computation. Okay, this is our model. Very ugly muscle model. Of course, first we discussed to take the shape of the very precise muscle, but we found it's very time consuming in one side. The other side is that even though we can find muscle shape from the anatomy, but that is not the natural shape. It is already applied and it is subjected to the pretension already. So we cannot see the free muscle shape. So because of these good reasons, we decided to just simplify by the simple tube muscles. This is like the German sausage. It's very simple tubes, the tube type muscles. But we computed from wire, and we little by little grow the tubes diameters, and in that way the muscles are pushing each other and making this ugly interrupted shape by themselves. So this is the result of interactions. We didn't provide this result. The muscles are just modeled by simple tube shape. Okay, now we need neurons, of course. And in the case of the bicep and tricep, Dr. Manishishin found the nice literature and made the 3D model of the neurons. But eventually, one of our master students, Takeuchi, he did all the job and he modeled the 128,000 motor neurons and 53,000 muscle spindle neurons and provided, distributed in the spine and also outside spine. And the difficult part is that we did our best to look for the literature, but we found that only 14 muscles have numbers of the motor neurons and muscle spindle neurons. And no other, there are some muscles that has non-motor neurons or the non-muscle spindle neurons, but the muscles that has known numbers for both motor neurons and sensory neurons are only 14. So how can we make the 1000 mass model? This is of course very difficult, but very simple. We have to make some kind of best guess. But we don't know what is the best guess. So we made very simple, or maybe this is brutal assumption, that we made the mapping of the horizontal line is the number of motor neurons per mass of muscle. And the vertical line is the number of muscle spindles over the total of motor neurons and sensory neurons. That means that the horizontal line is the ratio of mass and motor neurons, and the vertical line is the ratio of the sensory neurons among total number of neurons. So vertical side is showing the importance of senses, and horizontal side is maybe showing the importance of motors. So we plotted only 14 muscles that is known, then we can find this kind of the small circles. And our very brutal assumption that maybe the similar type of muscles or similar type of muscles with similar functions, they may share the very similar properties. Some muscle has more sensors, some muscle has more motors. So they are probably this kind of property shared by the similarity of the muscles. This is our very rough assumption. Well, based on this rough assumption, we made a very simple guess of all the 1000 muscles. Okay, motor neurons are distributed randomly at the one section, and they are the motor point. And the FEM the cell activity is computed by the distance from these motor neurons. And the muscle spindles, sensory neurons, are distributed all around the muscles. Well, then the we made very simple, again, the monosynaptic connections. This is, again, we haven't done very careful tuning of the parameters. But after making the very simple the connections, we try to see how it responds. So the simulation is to push the lower part of the leg with 20 newtons and see how the motion is distributed. This is the strain velocity of Dr. Skemoris, and this is the strain activity of the sensory neurons. This is the muscle activities. Well, the firing of the spiking neurons. It's not exciting at all, but okay. This is how it looks like. Right? Of course, we don't have skin and other the tissue, so the muscles are, you know, just freely moving. So we push the lower part of the leg and see how that sensation is sent to the sensory neuron and spread to the other muscles by monosynaptic reflex. Okay, this is how it looks like. Okay, now again, nothing is very scientific, but we just provided same simple spiking signal, that is 10 spikes per second for all the muscles of the limbs. in this case, we don't consider the collisions because the contact is very difficult. We can compute, but the, you know, doing the whole simulation is very unstable. Sometimes it goes wrong. So the stability is very difficult problem still. But we started with this. Okay, now connecting with Parkinson's disease brain. So the our Okinawa team developed the network as I already explained to you, and they provided us the activities. So this is the 20 by 20 column of the motor cortex, and each column typically includes 37, 38 neurons. So in total, there are 15,000 motor neurons, and this is the model of the cortex. I think that something like 1.3 millimeter square. So this is a very small portion of the motor cortex, and the because of the dysfunction of the dopamine cells, the basal ganglia has some strange activities, and then the motor cortex has some activities. And this is the typical the spiking signals, and the spiking rate is 8 hertz or 5 hertz. Okay, so we did again very brutal and simple assumption. There are 400 columns, and our four limbs had 374 muscles. We just connected one column to one muscle. So it's very brutal. There's no knowledge about this. This is a case when we assume some reasonable damping. We adjusted the damping parameters. I can show the motion without damping later, but this is with the damping. So we can't claim much, but this is how the muscles are vibrating. Okay, if we set zero viscosity. So this is the case without viscosity, no damping. So if the spiking activities of the 400 pounds are provided to four limbs, the muscles will vibrate in this way. And we don't know if this is like the tremor of the person, but this is what we are at in our level. And depending upon the set of viscosity, of course, vibration varies. So in the case of zero viscosity, the blue line is showing the tremor at the light wrist. And by changing the viscosity, of course, the vibration changes. This is the case of the left wrist. And we can see the elbow motion as well. So some vibration appears, but not as expected. Well, this is what we have done so far. It's very small, but we have connected the whole body FEM muscle model, and we made the last guess of the motor neurons and sensory neurons of all the muscles and distributed in the spine, and made the monosynaptic connection. And the Okinawa team developed the Parkinson's brain, very small, but 400 quarks, and we brutally connected and saw what appears as the muscle activities. Of course, the to investigate the more qualitative things is a very big challenge, and we have to spend more time. And one of our master's students last year picked up some additional work. I just want to briefly explain the Rohan Butihara. He is in now Dars in France, Toulouse, and he developed the neural model of vestibular systems. So he provided the 36,000 neurons for the vestibular systems, and we can simulate the vestibular activities. We haven't connected. And also he made the Daniel's sensor model of the soul. And we want to make the particular signal and the Daniel's sensation for the posture control of the body. But this is still the ongoing project. We have just distributed the neurons. Okay, just a few more. Of course, we can do a lot of experiment with small animals. This is just a walking and baseball playing mouse. But we made so anyway, we made the mocking from mouse bone to the human bone. They can geometrically morph, and by using this mocking, we can transform the human muscle to the mouse. So in this way, we made the the mouse neural model and made the motion capturing and the muscle activity estimation. So this is a very difficult experiment. We can measure the contact force with many these sensors, but the contact level is in less than 10 grams, few grams. It's very hard. And also muscle is not biped, right? That he's touching not only the legs, but also from the other part of the body. So the contact is very hard. And of course, the attaching the markers is the hardest part. So we spend a lot of time with our collaborators in the camp, and we make this kind of work. Well, there are many things for the neuromuscular skeletal system. We need to integrate the interneurons, and of course, the reflex system. Modeling for the reflex system has a lot of parameters to adjust. This is, I think, very interesting research work, and some of our students are working on that. Well, of course, it is very challenging, but we try to develop the physiologically possible the neuromuscular skeletal system from the spine to the body. And of course, brain model is being developed in many other groups. Of course, our collaborator in Okinawa is one of the wonderful groups, and we want to send this for modeling the human behaviors, and possibly in the future, maybe we can decide and simulate the human decision making system. That may be very challenging. Okay, thank you very much.
Is there any question in the room? Of course.
So, in your model, you have excluded the skin, right? And that's probably. And for instance, if you look at lamprey locomotion, there the stretch receptors in the skin are actually pretty important to keep the muscle synergies, let's say, synchronized to the movement. If you remove the skin, then it's just flopping around. Right? So, and also in your case, not having included the skin, is there not a big risk that the way you think about the control of the skeletal muscle system is another part of the state space, the way you really want to be?
Yes.
So how are you going to approach that? How are you going to bring in the skin and then its sensing capabilities and also, let's say, the elastic strength that it is?
Well, to be honest, skin is not difficult. We have it in the room and we don't have it yet, but skin is not. So anyway, I think you. For example, he has skin, and we have skin model in this sense, but we haven't made any mechanical properties in the skin. We have geometric model of skin, and skin is associated with different portions of the body. So we have to define the connection between the muscle tissue and skin. That may be challenging, but the skin itself is not very difficult. And in addition, we don't have the organs. That is
right.
Different part. Of course, we can include some balloon in the body, but we have one, but we want to have more detailed model.
Right.
Any other questions?
Also about the innervation of the muscle, I was curious about that. So, in a naive perspective on the skeletal muscle system, we all think about synergies. Mm-hmm. And often we think about synergies in a rather restricted way, like opponent forces. Right? But you could imagine that in your model, to get plausible movement, you also have to, let's say, rethink a little bit what we consider a synergy. Because maybe there are some of these muscles in your model that actually operate in isolation, while others are maybe embedded in much larger groups than simple, let's say, bipolar forces. Okay, can you comment on that?
Yes. Maybe. I think that is the, of course, by mechanical or physical relation, we have some interactions between muscles. I think that can explain part of the synergy. And the other part is, of course, the due to the neural systems. And the about 10 years ago, a long time ago, one of our PhD students, Yoshihiko, he is now in the AISP, he assumed the very simple encoding mathematical neural network in the spines and try to define the reflex system so that the natural daily motions like walking or running or bending can be best generated from the reflex system. So he made the training of neural network so that reflex system can contribute most to create the simple daily motions. So in that way, we can find some synergy to create typical motion of the person. But of course, this is based on mathematical assumption that the reflex system is organized to help the typical daily motions. That is our hypothesis, but we don't know how to evaluate those kinds things. Of course, with this complex neural system, some of our students are now looking at to train the neural connections, synaptic weight, to make that kind of the assumptions.
Any other question? No? In that case, let us thank the speaker again.